What I set out to do in this episode is not what I thought would happen.
This is the craziest thing I've ever done in my life.
What I learned about bees completely blew my mind, and this fact completely changed my life. What about the native bees? Is anyone even talking about them? Picture this. A tiny kingdom of thousands of busy workers working in tandem toward one common goal. Each member intentionally assigned a duty at birth, whether it's foraging for food and water, building the home, nursing the youth, or caring for their one chosen leader, the queen. Not her. Or her. I'm talking about her. The original queen bee.
You know, the chosen one who was born beside a number of potential unborn queen bees and used her stinger to kill the other prospects so she could go on to rule the hive for the next 1 to 7 years.
The vicious leader who convinced not only her colony, but the entire world that bees are so important to our ecosystem that we should do everything in our power to save them from extinction.
A melding! Oh, what a world, what a world!
And then, there's the little guys. What about them? The native bees that live in stems and hollow logs roaming the world searching for native plants. The misfits who fly solo, who don't live in hives, and are actually crucial to our survival. Maybe you've seen one, but you've mistaken them for a less magnificent creature like a mosquito. I think everyone in the office knows that I'm now obsessed with bees because it's all I can think about. Okay, so I started this episode to go look at this colony of bees or go look for honey. And then the more digging that I actually did, I realized that there's so many things about bees that humans don't know. When I learned about how the hive functions and how culty the hive is, say goodbye to what you thought you knew. I'm here to tell you how honeybees really function. We know they make honey, but worker bees make a special food for the queen. It's called royal jelly, and it's basically a super smoothie rich in bee vitamins and protein. The workers forage day and night, preparing her food into a royal jelly that turns her into some sort of super bee who rules the kingdom. The worker bees serve the queen day and night until she's satisfied. And when she's done, she hypnotizes them into a special trance using pheromones. The queen secretes a pheromone that sends the message that she is well. Tiny amounts of this scent collect on the bees, and as they move through the hive, other worker bees can smell that the kingdom is at ease. When the queen is ready to duplicate her army, the workers split in a process called swarming. That's right, giant populations of bees doubling in size. Versus this little guy, the underdog. The one who isn't fuzzy, who comes in a rainbow of colors like blue and green, not just yellow and black. The ones who live in undisturbed leaves and twigs, unknowingly swept up by well-meaning folks like you and me. Have native bees been drowned out by the commercial success of honeybees? Is anyone even talking about them? I don't want to get into native species yet. First, I went to Prince Edward County to see the kingdom for myself.
We went undercover to take down the queen.
Yeah, hot day. How are you?
Randy.
Nice to meet you.
Meet Dan. Randy, owner of Randy's Bees, honey enthusiast and keeper of the queen. He let the no-brainers crash his colony on our search to find out more about bees. Thanks, Randy.
So your bees will go out into the area and they will forage and do whatever they need to do.
They will forage as far as 6 kilometers away.
Wow.
Yeah.
That is so cool.
They're going to go and find forage wherever they can find it. And that means they'll probably end up in town because lots of people are watering their plants.
Kind of like having an outdoor cat that just kind of like goes out during the day and like will come back at night, but they're your bees.
It's a little bit.
That's a bit of a stretch.
It's kind of like, oh yeah, having an outdoor cat. It's kind of like having an outdoor cat. It's kind of like having an outdoor cat.
This colony had 30 hives and an army of almost 2 million bees.
The smoke distracts the bees.
It impedes their ability to communicate with each other.
We used some sort of smoke mechanism to trick the queen's army and search through thousands of honeybees, aka the settler bees who were brought to North America in the 17th century. They can technically provide competition to native bee species for limited resources. We were searching for the monarch whose sole life purpose was to indoctrinate her workers and hoard liters of sweet, sticky honey. And then we found her at the bottom of the hive, hiding in her sea of stormtroopers.
like some sort of Karen convincing thousands of workers to sell makeup in a corporate structure that is definitely a pyramid scheme, despite what she tells you. So, I stole her precious honey in solidarity with the native bees. And after seeing all these honeybees and no native bees, I started to wonder.
I couldn't help but wonder.
I couldn't help but wonder. The whole world thinks that honeybees make the world go round, but bees pollinate in different ways. Think of it like a puzzle. Native species evolved alongside our native plants, and thus, these bees are better pollinators for native plants. Native bees don't even live in hives. They live in the ground or in wood or in hollow stems. They're out here on their own fighting the good fight without a big ass kingdom to live in. So how do we actually save the bees?
Field trip.
Please let this be a normal field trip.
Where do we start?
Should we put sugar, honey to this?
We grabbed our bikes and went on the hunt.
We decided to ditch the city walls and search for pollinators somewhere within this concrete jungle. It would be tough,
so cute.
But we aired up our tires and headed east. We took our bikes to Tommy Thompson Park, and right here in the middle of the biggest city in Canada was a thriving home full of native species coexisting in a beautiful ecosystem that had grown over old buildings and construction debris. But that's not the point. Like, when you see how many plants and animals actually are living here right now, we've taken it all away from them, and this tiny little spot is thriving with life. Messed up.
What do you think?
Humans suck. The issue with pollinators is actually a lot bigger and more complicated.
They need the space that's natural to them.
What we can do in this moment is, like, give the bees their home.
Right.
Oh my god, I'm actually getting really sad.
So we went shopping for a native plant garden.
They have switchgrass.
It's black-eyed Susan.
And we got some bee balm.
We researched some plants that were helpful to native pollinators, and we went to town.
That's nice.
The reality is, yeah, it's a problem way bigger than you and me. And maybe it's not our fault. But we can't escape that native pollinator populations are declining, and these pollinators are custom made to be here, finding food and shelter in native plant life that are meant to be here as well. And we needed to make space. We noticed that when we took a look around, there were already pollinators in the garden. Not to mention earthworms and snails as well.
I'm actually sweating and covered in dirt.
But as we planted this garden, we felt like we were a part of something bigger. Like we were connected to why we were on this weirdo magical planet in the first place. And maybe having a pollinator garden would remind us that we're part of our own ecosystem and that we can't survive without the help of the living creatures that are all around us. So yeah, native bees need native homes. And this fact completely changed my life. Comment below. I think everyone in the office knows that I'm now obsessed with bees because it's all I can think about. The queen lives in the hive. She goes on one flight her whole life, and it's called her maiden flight, and that's when she goes to mate.